travel a lot, so you'll probably have to.
I will.
All right, well, I'm going to go ahead and get started. So welcome to all of you, mechanical engineers and others that might have showed up as well. We welcome everybody around here. So we're here to talk about internships today, and hopefully everybody's been interested in that. And hopefully if you don't, maybe you'll know by the end of it. So what I'd like to do first is I'm going to start sending around a sign-up sheet. Go ahead and put, you know, if you're here for a class, go ahead and put that in there. Make sure you, also if you're from another department or whatever, also would like to see that. I'd like to see who's visiting with us. So I'll start that over here. Okay, so we'll go ahead and get started. And again, talking about internships, I've got a few companies and different things just kind of spread over. I think that's similar to what you saw on the flyers. You know, these are all people, you know, it's a select group that we all have, existing or talking to and have different relationships with these companies. Some of them are local, some of them are regional, but it's part of what I'm really trying to do right now is to try to build these relationships with companies so that you guys have opportunities to get this experience and eventually, you know, get jobs later on down the line, which is really important. That's what we are. While we do engineering, you know, eventually to get a job that makes a difference in the world, and so you can kind of see some of the impact you might have. So for an agenda real quick, I'm going to go over some things just about, and it is focused on mechanical engineers, so you know, try to think holistically a little bit. There are skills that you can extract from any major thing, but really thinking about professional skills that mechanical engineers do. What do they do in the workplace? What do you need? In terms of skills, what is an internship exactly? Well, you know, sometimes there's questions about that. You know, how does it affect me as a student? And so we want to really get into that a little bit. And then I got more than two potential positions I was adding right at the last minute, so I've got several different positions. Also got some other possibilities that may be in existence out there and some resources we'll talk about. And then finally, we'll end up the last half or so of the talk. I'm going to bring some students up here that have had internships. There's actually more than the ones I invited here that have had internships, so we can pull up some people from the audience as well that can give us some feedback. But you can ask questions, you know, how do you get a job, how did it work, what was it like walking into that first day? So any of those things are fair game. And also, just so you know, I'm pretty easygoing about stuff. If you have a question, about something I'm saying or something we're talking about, jump right in. You know, raise your hand, and we'll stop and talk about it real quick. I can field those questions. Okay, so real quick, just a couple of examples. So most of the time, whenever you're a mechanical engineer or an electrical engineer for that matter, you typically the last time I say this, the last time you're going to be called a mechanical engineer will be probably the day you graduate, and maybe whenever you're like talking about your resume. Eventually, you sort of get tied into a more of a functionality type thing. So you might be a manufacturing engineer. So you would be involved in a variety of, you know, quality control processing, cooling, material selection, things like that. That's how you sort of interface yourself with the industry. It's not always clear that the mechanical engineer is going to be the person that fits into that, but they can. Also, a chemical engineer might fit into that. A electrical engineer can fit into that, industrial engineer can fit into that. So they sort of regroup you a little bit once you get an industry. Manufacturing is one. Robotics, some of the classes that you might take or some of the skill sets that you might need for something like that. Here on the right, we had our seminar talk last week was on systems integration for the Mars rover and how hard that was and how difficult that was. Hopefully a lot of you were there to see that. Power generation, this is a big hot topic for mechanical engineers now, currently. How do we get the power that we're going to, you know, be able to use for the next 20, 30 years, and what's the source of that power? And renewables are big, geothermal and wind, solar's out there, but then we also still have a lot of the traditional power. We have nuclear, we have, which I guess is sort of in between, but we have nuclear, we have coal, natural gas, you know, hydro here in Idaho, things like that all exist. We have a substantial involvement in those areas. Biomedical, we have our department is the mechanical and biomedical group, and so a lot of mechanical engineering and biomedical engineering that goes into engineering devices, things like this for for inserting into the body in various ways. So, you know, that's take engineering, you have to combine a little bit of biology with it to make to be effective. We have a lot of companies that are hiring in that. Automotive transportation, we don't have any Ford Motor Company here in town, but we have had some students that have worked for companies that are integrated with the automotive groups. And we do have Motive Power, which does railroad engines, and they do that right out on Federal Way, big company. Aeronautics and astronautics, this is kind of where I came from in my career. Spent some time with Lockheed Martin, and then also with NASA for a bit of time in there. You pretty much have everything going together in aerospace. Everything has to be built to a very, very low safety factor. It's kind of an interesting world, a lot of complexity. Aerospace, again, same thing. This is a couple of pictures from my background. I used to build these guys, and we worked in Marshall Space Flight Center in Huntsville up there. We worked on these engines here, the SSNEs. So that was a lot of stuff going on with that. So I just wanted to go through that really briefly, just to kind of start have you thinking about the things that mechanical engineers do more so than, you know, it's not about heat transfer. It's not about getting a position in dynamics. You do something with it. You use those skills, but you won't necessarily be called that kind of an engineer when you leave. But beyond that, has anybody heard of the T-shaped professional model? People in my class, previous class. Anybody else, T-shaped professional? Okay, you're in my class too. Okay, so a T-shaped professional. So there's more to it than just the technical skills that you walk out of whenever you have in a class from going through a class, or getting some experience through a class. We think of it as a T, and so the vertical stem, if you will, the vertical part of the T, is about those deeper skills. Like, that's what makes you an engineer, and you know the heat transfer, you know the dynamics, the materials properties, things like that, and you know some depth in that area. You know, compared to somebody else that you might run into on the street. You know, you're going to know that whenever you leave here. Now, the thing that you really need as well is the horizontal bar across the top of this T. And that's the translational skills that go into how do you use the technical skills effectively across on a team and communicate effectively with others. And those are very, very important skills to have. And they call them boundary crossing competencies. And so you have to be able to talk with the scientists that you're working with as an engineer. You have to be able to talk with the business groups, the management groups. Maybe you have marketing groups and advertising groups that you have to be able to communicate your ideas in a way to them that they can understand, so that they can communicate to the broader public. You know, and that's sometimes hard for an engineer to do. But so those skills across that top part of that bar, that's where you need to be thinking about making sure that you have those as well, because those are the things employers are going to look for. Those are important, very important skills. In fact, there was a survey done back in 2012 that says skills and competencies needed for initial success in the job. So why do you need these? Highest priority, you know, perform with integrity, so ethical behavior, professional behavior, that's very important. Be able to solve problems, managing time and priorities, take initiative, think critically, analyze, evaluate, interpret, contribute to a team, orally communicate effectively, build and sustain working professional relationships. You know, a good portion of those are part of that top bar. That's what they're looking for. Those are highest priority. You need to make sure you have those things. And even in the very important category, which is not as critical but still important, you know, you still have acquiring knowledge, effectively communicate through writing, plan and manage a project, lots of things that also go into that same area where you have to be able to cross over, cross boundaries, and be able to talk, communicate, work on the team. That's very important. So, some of the other data that we have, this is a more recent study that was done here locally, actually, through the Idaho Society of Professional Engineers, ISPE. And we did a poll, and we asked them, basically, how long does it take for a typical engineer to come into their organization and become competent? I want to say fresh out to competency. You know, fresh out is right out of school. You walk out the door with your diploma, you go into a job. How long does it take for you to become competent? I know you probably don't think of it that way, But when you walk out of here, you're kind of not going to really know that much about some of these things. You're going to walk into a job, it's going to be like going into kindergarten. And so you see this, and these are industries, different ones. And so look here, at least a good, the majority, I would say, for the most part, the biggest chunk of them are saying it's more than 24 months before you become competent, before you can be trusted to, you know, handle a project on your own. So that's over 2 years of mentoring and tutoring that you're going to have to go through. And, you know, and the thing is, a lot of these companies don't really have time for that. So if you start this process early with an internship, you can be accelerating this process so it makes you a better employee. You're ready to get in there and make a difference quicker. What does that mean? You get to advance quicker, you get to be promoted quicker, you get the big paycheck quicker. And the companies like that because they don't have to wait for you to get good at what you do for 24, 48 months, whatever that is. So employers know this. They said, so what is the expectation for prior professional experience whenever you're hired into a full-time job? And so if you take out the no expectation, 8%, and you say there's some moderate, high, and required, that adds up, in my book, to 92%. Over 90% of the employers say you need some prior professional experience to be able to be hired by their company. So think about that. That's the reason why an internship is important. This is where you get that prior professional experience. If you want to be employable, if you want to look good to these employers, you really need to get in here and take the initiative to get this position. That's why I want to speak to you today. This is it, right here. Just as a couple of other things that are sort of floating around out there, this is more specific to Idaho. This is a recent issue of the IBR, which is the Idaho Business Review, which is a local publication, but it's for the state. And there was several people from Boise State and also the Department of Labor interviewed, and some other people active in the community were interviewed and talked about, you know, where are these problems, or what are some of the things that we're facing in terms of economic development for our state, our community, and that sort of thing. And really what they're talking about is building a qualified workforce, and that's you guys. It really is. All of you together are part of this, building a qualified workforce. And they said, what's the problem for Idaho right now? I mean, there's a relatively low unemployment rate, but still, finding skilled workers is a problem. Finding enough of the applicants for the jobs, and it's really about finding enough skilled applicants. I'm sure they can find, you know, any number of people that come in off the street and say, hey, I want the job, you know, but they're probably not going to necessarily want them. And the other problem is aging workforce. Well, there's a couple of them. So aging workforce. So they said 46% of their current workforce will be lost to retirement within the next 5 years. So imagine what that looks like. And if it takes you 2-3 years to be good at what you do, enough to be able to be trusted to, you know, fly the plane or whatever it is, that's kind of scary. It's half. We lose half the older part of the workforce that has the experience, has been through these boundary translational experiences that allow them to understand how to work together, and they're going to be gone. And so, you know, having, you know, being able to replace those people with really qualified, highly energetic people that come in with good technical skill set, but also these boundary crossing skill sets, is very important. Also, just the fact that the economy is changing here, and we have new necessary skill sets that are coming on board that we have to, you know, address. So you as engineers are primed for being able to walk into those positions with these new skill sets and bring new ideas, new creativity, new innovation to these industries. And so that's going to be on, that's you guys taking this out, understanding how to, you know, be innovative and creative with your new technology. Implementing it, that's going to be a big part of the new economy. So I see that as another problem within the workforce, but also those are opportunities. So as you see, the answer is basically, and it's being seen by our entire university, is internships, job shadowing possibilities, things like that. We're really pushing that, those professional development ideas, because those are part of this bridge to career. So when you think about that, you probably heard people say that. But But it's like, you know, yes, you can walk out of this classroom, but are you going to be ready to get into that job? And is that gap going to, you know, how do you shrink the gap to competent performance? It's really about that. Shrink the gap. And that's what this is about too, bridge the career. And so that's what internships are. And so other things in your classrooms, hopefully like project-based learning and all that kind of stuff, while it may be difficult and painful at times, also addresses that as well. So what is an internship? Yes, you probably have some idea what that is, but basically an internship's working and learning relationship between an organization, can be any number of organizations, and then a student, somebody like you. And the student gets money, usually, not always, but in most cases. And they get to learn new skills. That's that T-shaped professional model. You know, they hopefully a lot of the translational skills, probably some vertical ones too, but primarily is those crossbar skills. You're developing a new relationship. It's like an extended job interview that works in your favor. Typically, if you do a good job, they like you. They're like, hey, you know, this person's shown some great work ethic. That's hard to show in a resume. Hey, I've got great work ethic. You know, everybody says that. Then you get on the job, and then you have to prove it. If you've already proven it, then you don't have to go through that process. It's a whole different deal. Gaining engineering experience, gaining that prior professional engineering experience, really good. And you also get to earn academic credit. So we as a mechanical department, I don't think all the departments are exactly the same, but as a mechanical department, we offer academic credit for internship experiences. We'll talk a little bit more about that. So you get 3 credits towards any technical elective. Up to 3. The organization, they get, you know, cheap labor. I mean, you know, even if you're making $20 an hour, you're still cheaper than a full-time engineer. So they're actually doing better in that regard. That helps them. And you're thinking $20 an hour, that's pretty sweet, right? I'm guessing. It's good. Better than working at McDonald's. Although there's nothing wrong with working at McDonald's. Long-term interview to evaluate, just talked about that. And then also, they get to promote their corporate reputation. I mean, they come in, they are hiring internships for the community, and, you know, really boost their prestige in the community. I think that they get that opportunity as well. And, you know, for them, having this temporary workforce allows them to adjust to ebbs and flows in their business model a little bit easier because they don't have to hire a permanent employee that they didn't have to worry about benefits that extend for an indefinite period of time. So it's really important. All right, so I know there's a lot of words here. Let's read the big ones. So basically, how does the process work? So you want to prepare your resume. You haven't already done that. So think about how you're going to do that. And we'll talk a little bit more about resume building. I will tell you this. You can work with me as an appointment. But also, I know Leandra Abarusa, who's back there. Leandra, if you haven't met Leandra, you need to meet Leandra. And she has done some outstanding work with helping people get their resumes in fantastic shape. And helping you take your skill sets and turn them into ways that there are things that can actually be promotable to an employer in effective ways. We'll do a little more of that later on in the semester, but if you want to get a jump start. I'd also do some research and you know, find out what you want to do. You know, what are you interested in? And we'll talk about various jobs here that might be out there, but what are you interested in? You know, if you don't have excitement and passion for something, it's going to be harder to get to show that to the employer, and they're probably gonna look at you and say, hey, you know, I'm not sure if that person's the right person for us. And part of that's the excitement that you show. So you look in the research, you get excited about it, and you say, I want to go do that. People like to work with people who are excited about what they do. I mean, think about the people that you interact with on a daily basis. Do you like people that are passionate about what they do? Or do you like people that are like, whatever, I don't care. Then you seek out the opportunities. So work your networks. Work your networks. That may be through the Career Center here. There's a whole website for searching out job positions. Internships are on there. Talk to other students. Come to seminars like this. We have people coming from industry in these types of events occasionally. I'm building these networks as well. And so if you have an interest in a particular area, you can come see. You can shoot an email to me and say, hey, do you know anybody in this area? Do you know anybody at this company? And I can't guarantee that I know everybody, but I know a few people. So we can, you can certainly do that. You can also go out and go to ASME events or other, you know, they have a local chapter for ASME. Go out and meet the industry professionals here in town. You know, those are perfectly legitimate ways to build your network. And then if you do seek the academic credit side of things, you can go through the Career Center, and they have a website, so you complete an application there for an internship. Once you have an internship in mind, you go to the Career Center website, and you fill out the application. And then it comes to me, and I might kick it back to you for more information. I might want to dig into the position a little bit. It needs to be engineering related. I'm not going to give you an internship to work at Starbucks unless you're engineering a new espresso maker or something like that. You know, and that'd be cool. And I'd like that. In fact, you'd have to bring one to me after you're done, so I can test it out. But that would be so it needs to be engineering related. And then you work for a semester. At the end, there's a technical report, and then you turn that in, and then you get a grade. And so that's three credits towards your MB Technical Elective, plus you get to be more employable as well. So it's across the board, good deal. Some of the resources that we have here at the university that you need to be familiar with is the Career Center has, actually they just updated their, as far as I can tell, their interface. It's really nice. They've got Bronco jobs. You can go sign up now. Got a whole list of things in there. I went down through a few of them just today before I came in here. A pretty decent list. You can search on mechanical engineers or whatever other things you want to search on, and there's things out there. It's really interesting. It's a really nice job that they've done. That's also a place where the internship application portal is, where you go and sign up for the academic credit. It's out there. They also have different workshops and things like that that, you know, that would potentially benefit you as well. So that's a great place. You don't have to be a senior getting ready to graduate before you start this process. In fact, I would say every single one of you needs to be on this site this afternoon after you finish this seminar. Our BSU College of Engineering, like I mentioned, Leandra, she has done some fantastic work in resume review, and I don't know how she has time for all of it, but she does such a fantastic job. And she also sends out email announcements. And if you should be getting those, right? Everybody gets those? She sends out some really good stuff, so if you're not paying attention to those emails, make sure you do. We also have social media announcements. We have Facebook presence, LinkedIn presence. You know, join up on those social media sites. I mean, that's another good place to get this information. Same for our department. We have social media announcements at both of those same sites. I have quite a few industry contacts. If I don't have somebody, I don't have a problem seeking out one if I need to. And we also have research projects. You know, we also have several faculty doing research, and we hire people into those positions, and they get an opportunity to do research and get an internship. So depending on how that works with the faculty, I've got one of our students is going to talk about that here in a second. Several upcoming events. There's a happy hour coming up, and a Bronco happy hour coming up in about a week, looks like. All these are over in the sub. And I believe that's more of just a get to know the Career Center type of thing, as far as I can tell, based on that. But in preparation for that, the BSU, the entire university Career Center, Career Fair is on Wednesday, October 14th, also in the sub. And then the College of Engineering Career Fair is in November 12th. So you need to be ready. Even if you're a freshman or sophomore, I'd say you need to start going to those events. Because talking to employers, getting used to speaking engineering language to people that are, you know, employers, is really good practice. You don't want to wait till you're senior to start practicing. You know, So get your resumes ready beforehand and start practice your talking and your interaction and communication with these, engineers have this reputation. They might, probably not, most of you, probably not in this group, but they don't have a tendency to be able, you know, they don't necessarily like to, you know, be all vivacious and talk to people, and so they're more standoffish. Maybe that's probably other people, but still it's good practice. I find if I'm not teaching class for a period of weeks or months, I start getting less interactive too. So it just depends on how often you do it. some of the potential opportunities out there that these are just a few. I'm just throwing these out there almost off the top of my head. I do have a bunch more than this. Idaho Power has some positions in energy efficiency and also in atmospheric science modeling. Power Engineers they hired, I believe, two interns last summer. They have a pretty regular basis. They're hiring interns. Motive Power, Manufacturing Design. They haven't hired recently, but I have been in contact with them, and they were talking about establishing a bigger relationship with them. So I'm hopeful that that's going to really get bigger. So they're the ones that do the trains. They make the engines, train engines, and that sort of thing. And they do that on Federal Way, sort of by the Home Depot out there. ConAgra Lamb Weston, we actually started a partnership with them just this last year. And one of the students in senior design, who couldn't be here today, I was going to ask him to talk about this, but he actually was in senior design in the spring, 41. He interned with the company that was, his project was part of this ConAgra relationship. And so then he went and interned with them all summer, and now he's back here in the fall, and he's so basically he had an internship experience with the company, and now he's coming back to finish his senior design project. So it's this interesting back and forth, almost like a co-op experience a little bit. And so we're piloting that, but I figure that's going to continue. We've got several different NASA interactions, PNNL up in Washington is, the guy who just walked into my office just yesterday and wanted to talk about internships just yesterday. I didn't get a chance to talk with him, so I don't have much to say about what that entails, but he left me his card and he wanted to talk, so hopefully that blossoms into something. The United Launch Alliance, that's ULA, Commercial Space Flight, that's something that actually, I found that job. I used to work with ULA when I was with Lockheed Martin, and they had a position on the Bronco jobs. So I was going down through there, and I'm like, wow, I need to reach out to these guys, see if I can develop that personal relationship with them. They're out there. So if you have any interest in any of those, you know, those are some things just to kind of get your mind thinking a little bit. Another one that we have. There's just been posted. I know Travis Pruitt over there was interned there this summer, and we'll bring him up in a second. You can ask him questions. But this is the website. Basically, there's just a recent posting for a summer 2016 internship in mechanical engineering. And I know there's other students besides Travis that have worked there. I know probably three or four students. I think at least three or four total that have worked there in the last couple of years. So they do mining operation there in northern Nevada. Another one that we'll have a student talk about here is DC Engineering here locally. These guys are just doing fantastic. I'll let Hope talk about this a little bit more, but they're looking for people. They're looking for full-time and interns right now, and they need this semester, like right now. And they're just covered up with work, and they don't know what to do. I mean, it's scary, because they got so much work, and they don't know what to do with it. So they need interns to help out. So that's a place that you can go in, and I'll wait. You can tell how successful you were. So. The other one that is just now coming out is I've been in contact with INL, Idaho National Labs, out in eastern Idaho, near, I guess, Pocatello, Idaho Falls. I'm sure most of you are familiar with it. If you're interested in that, they have right now, this is right off of, I've been in contact with their coordinator for internships. They have over 300 undergraduate and graduate students each year that are interning out there, and very, very few are from Boise State. And I'm like, why? Why is that? So that they don't apply. These are people coming from all over the country to work in that national lab, and people in Idaho or our students aren't applying. So I want to change that. I think this is an opportunity. I don't know if you have an interest in this area. That's a substantial organization that's doing a lot of really great things. And so having, I'm sorry, that's a big old link. If you want, I'll certainly be able to email you that link if you'd rather than have to copy it down. But they do a lot of different work in a lot of different areas. And mechanical engineers are the ones they hire the most. Of all of those other positions, those are the ones that go in there. Of course, they hire others, but they do a lot of mechanical engineers. So, any other questions at this point? well, what I'm gonna do now is I'm gonna.
It's Alejandro.
Never showed up. Okay, all right. Well, we'll just. He's on here, but he'll have. I'll have to talk for him. Okay, so why don't you guys come up? Five of you guys, and then why don't you come up too? And maybe just go ahead and stand up front. I won't let you guys introduce yourselves. You don't have to do this order if you don't want to.
Maybe you go up here.
Yes, sit up there in front, please. I'll stand behind. Say who you are and how did you get your position? Basically, what's your position?
Okay, so my name is Jake Davlin. I had an intern for L3 Electron Devices over the summer. I was flown down in California, San Carlos, and as an associate engineer, basically prototyping and designing traveling wave tubes for military defense and communications. With that internship, I gained a lot of experience, especially in fields that I wasn't really expecting. I've worked with electrical engineers and all sorts of different, really intelligent people. And with that, I've just gained like a huge like foundation to like how to, I don't know, go about further our future internships. But how I got to where I am is just applying myself. Basically, starting from 2012, my freshman year, there was an opportunity for internships through the STEM program, and I was fortunate enough to get into Dr. Plumlee's lab, the CMEMS lab, and from there just built my resume. By myself, I saw something that caught my interest, I would apply for it. The worst thing that can happen when you apply for something is they say no, but most likely, if you have the experience, you'll get it. So, yeah, that's a little bit of my background. Thanks.
Cool. Cole Colbert, and I'm working for DC Engineering right now. And so actually, I was in Dr. Plumlee's internship class last semester, and my now boss came in, just talked about the internship and everything. And so basically, in our work, I actually really wanted an intern right now, because the work sucks. Well, I mean, it doesn't suck. Because when I came in, I was doing all the groundwork, setting up sheets and AutoCAD, and now that I'm actually working as a project manager, I don't like to do that stuff. And so if one of you guys would all come in and help me out, I'd really love that. But anyways, going on from there, so after he came in, I took a couple hours just started writing out a cover letter. I worked for Albertsons for 5 years, so I was working with grocery systems and I kind of knew layouts of stores. So going from there, he really liked that. And so that was a big thing that I really didn't think would be worthwhile for anything engineering, but it ended up working out. So then, getting ready for the interview, probably spend 4 to 6 hours just looking up any kind of refrigeration systems, looking at refrigerants, and just trying to get every single little bit of information I could before the interview, so I had questions to ask and make it seem like I knew what I was talking about. Then from there, he liked what I had to say, and so then I entered for, I think, only 2 months before he offered me full-time. And so this is a company that's really looking for people to stick on, and they're looking for people that are going to stay around because we are getting so many jobs in right now and there's just not enough people to do them all. So it's like, it's going to be a great place to work and they're looking for long-term people.
There's like 60 engineers now, right? So I think that's
the whole company?
Well, I thought in Boise was what he was talking about.
No, we have 100 and something now.
In the
Boise.
In Boise? 100 engineers, yeah. Or 100 employees?
There's probably like 80 engineering employees okay. Now.
So, I mean, that's a huge group. It's not Hewlett-Packard, but it's a very large engineering hiring firm around. So
the refrigeration firm that I'm working for, I think last year they had 3 people. Right now we're 8. We're just looking to further expand. So it's just something that's really growing right now.
Yeah, take it on.
Lily? I'm Lilia. I am a mechanical engineering major. This is my
11th
semester of school. So I am a senior. My internship took place in a research lab here on campus. I work with Dr. David Strada in the Integrated Nanomaterials Lab, which focuses on very small things. My project focuses on carbon nanotubes and film transistors. So in the lab, I do a lot of hands-on, lots of literature reading. I am the one that fabricates the thin film of carbon nanotubes, and then I go on to characterize the devices and analyze them using MATLAB, Excel, things that I've learned in class that really came in handy see what kind of performance that we get from those devices. I got this the research position by pretty much applying myself. I joined kind of clubs to see what they had to offer. I joined a club called LSAM, and they provide summer research funding for a couple of students every summer, and so I got a position with her, and then she paired me up with Dr. David Estrada, and so I've been able to keep the position year-round through the school year.
I'm a mechanical engineering major, and I started in Dr. Plumlee's lab as well my freshman year, and from there I kept interest and kept building my resume, and the way I got my internship at AT was a little different. They called me because they had seen my speech with President Obama, and basically when I walked in, they had known that I had speaking abilities, I could communicate, but then they also knew that I was a leader of my faculty. So when I got in there, I work on an engine team, and actually you see that little paper, that picture right there on the wall? That is,
Did you put that up there?
No, I didn't. I always am a little happy when I walk in here and see that. So that's printed off an Indigo printer, which is like HP's biggest printer, and that's downstairs, well not downstairs, it's in one of the buildings at HP. I don't actually work on that, but I thought that was really cool that it was sitting up there. They do lots of R&D on the Indigo printer at HP Boise. So HP Boise is a research and development lab or site, and what they do is they create all the engines. So Boise State has all these HP computers, and I work on an engine team, which are the ones that create those printers. They either fix the old ones or they come up with the actual new printers. So the engine team I'm working on right now, they're actually developing those new printers. But when I came in, they said, we look at your resume and see your interest, and we're not going to put you on a printer project. What they put me on instead was a robotic hand project. We have a robotic development lab at HP, and we're developing new robotics technology. So what I work on right now is a robotic hand that's 3D printed and has all five digits, and it's a visually controlled robotic hand. So what you do is you put your hand up in front of the camera and it follows you, basically. So they gave me that position because they knew I had leadership skills, but they also knew that I had to keep the robotics from my resume. So that was really cool. It gave me the ability to kind of lead, because I designed the whole robot. I didn't do the programming, but I designed each step of the robot. And then, you know, kind of took off from there. I have a mentor, his name is Hans, and he's really awesome. He's mechanical engineering too. And then besides that, I also did some team development by not only working with engineers, but I also did a lot of work on social media, because he has contest for HP Twitterings worldwide. And I went ahead and became a part of that. And that led me to be able to bring my project not just to the team at Boise State or Boise, but I also got to meet the CTO of HP. He came down to Boise site and met with me, the CEO, the CTOs, they all live in Palo Alto, California. So not here in Boise. They came down specifically to look at the robot development lab, got to show my project. They were really interested in it. And so next year I'm looking forward to an invitation to actually go down to HP Palo Alto. So working in HP labs, working with really exciting technology happens at HP. So it's super cool. And and the guy here, there's a Boise State recruiter here by the name of Richard Gines. So if you ever see his name floating around, he's the guy you want. He's the guy you want to meet, Richard Gines.
He's a local, like a local Boise?
He's a Boise State recruiter.
Oh, Boise State. But he comes on site periodically, is that right?
Mm-hmm. So he came on site periodically. The director of my lab contacted him to contact Boise State and find me, basically. So if you ever see a thing floating around, that's definitely the guy I want to.
And that's a new one to me, but we also have a lot of other good contacts with HP as well.
Yeah.
So we're building a nice relationship with them. Thanks. Josh?
I'm Josh Hirsch. I'm a senior in the mechanical engineering department. This summer I got to work with Double L Manufacturing. It's a firm that specializes in potato harvesting equipment and transportation. Throughout it, I gained a lot of intangible skill sets for an engineer. I was able to improve legacy design through the implementation of strategies that protect against wear and corrosion. I also got to improve manufacturability with the implementation of engineering department standards that provide a consistent format and convention for the production team to follow. Also, I was able to contribute contribute to a stable foundation of engineering documentation by modeling with a convention that emphasizes the precision in utilizing 3D software, which includes like structuring with sub-weldments, weldments, sub-assemblies, and assemblies. One of the projects I was able to work on was the development of a new power carrying system for their telescoping there. A previous method of retracting and extending this cable system utilized a cord reel, which was costly and left much to be desired in control of sagging cable and aesthetics. So what I did, I developed a festoon system, and the festoon system was a noticeable upgrade to the telescoping conveyor, and it could be utilized in future designs. This was a successful design, and Double O was very satisfied with it. I heard about the job opportunity through a former ESU graduate, pursued it through him, and then went down for an interview and started there this last semester.
So a former mechanical graduate? Okay. Yeah. And so he already worked there, or he or she, they already worked there?
He was working there too.
Okay. At that point, so. Cool. Very good. Thanks.
Travis? My name's Travis Pruitt. I'm also a senior here in mechanical engineering. This summer I got to complete my third internship with Barrick, summer-long internship. I guess it'd be four if you count winter break too, but basically they're one of the world's largest mining companies. They have a bunch of mines in Nevada, which most of those mines you can get to within about 4 to 5 hours from here in Boise, so it's fairly close. You know, that slide that Dr. Plumlee had up earlier, you know, they pay for your housing if you need it, and it's a paid internship, and it's a really good experience. You know, the 4 years that I've worked there, I've had the opportunity to work on a wide variety of projects, not just mechanical engineering related, but reliability engineering as well. So we would track the performance of different things on the mine site and try to make improvements to our maintenance strategies and stuff like that. So it was cool because I got to see a lot of mechanical engineering type projects like feasibility studies and adding some heat exchangers to the various processes and stuff like that, but got to see another side of engineering as well. I guess one of the easiest, or how I got the internship, was I was kind of from Nevada, I am from Nevada, and I guess not kind of.
Yeah.
So anyway, yeah. It was close to Idaho, so it almost counts. No. Anyway, I grew up around the mining industry, so I was kind of aware that they hired summer interns. I've had previous mining experience before starting internships, and you know, it's the mining industry kind of gets forgotten for a lot of us engineers. I've talked to a lot of you even who really don't know much about the mining industry, but being as close as it is, it's a great opportunity for mechanical engineers to kind of get out and get some experience. You know, the process area where I worked this summer is it's like Barrick's world-class facility for gold processing, and you walk in the door and you're like, oh, okay, you know, I pictured mining as like guys in a mine with a canary cage walking around underground, but you know, you walk in the door of this big shop and there's just pumps and piping systems and all sorts of moving parts, and for mechanical engineers, like, oh, okay, I see how I fit in here. So it's really cool, but you know, getting the position, I would really stress the resume. You know, you can't always go down and talk to people ahead of time, whereas in Nevada, you know, I had to send them my resume, and fortunately I had previous mining experience, but building a strong resume was really key to that, I'd say. And you know, Dr. Plumlee mentioned it earlier, but Leandra really helped me with that, and Dr. Plumlee as well have both reviewed my resume probably 4 or 5 times each. So I'd really suggest getting started on that. Yeah, that's about it for me. Do you guys have any questions for me specific?
Yeah, we can open it up to anybody.
A couple of you mentioned like what kind of made your resume stand out, but for those of you who didn't, like what would you say kind of was the biggest like block that you put on the resume that you think might help, or that you don't help?
I know the greatest way to build up your resume is just to find things that you're interested in and kind of just like apply yourself towards that. I got in with microgravity because of Camille, and just because it seemed really cool and it seemed like a great opportunity. And I did that last semester, so in fact that helped me a lot with how I got my internship. It it's never too late to sign up for things, even if it's even if you're contributing just a little bit. That's how you move up.
I would say just put in kind of unique things. I mean, I know initially when I was starting out, I was like, what could I, you know, possibly put on my resume that was engineering based, because I worked in retail for a long time. But I put stuff like on like the intro engineering class, like the service learning class, I put that on there, and I work with teams, stuff like that, just kind of based it on classes initially.
That crossbar stuff.
Yeah.
You were able to extract that top horizontal bar stuff out of your your other experiences. Maybe it would have more technical, but then that it became more prevalent, more relevant for you. So, awesome. Anybody else?
Yeah, I would stress that too, the teamwork sort of thing, you know, knowing how to work in teams and communicate effectively. That was something that, I don't actually remember if that's on my resume, but that's something that my employer was really looking for. Fortunately, I had talked to them previously because I'd been there multiple summers, but, you know, that's something that they really look for, is being able to communicate and, you know, not just, you need to know the technical skills, but you need to be able to get along and work with other people and communicate what you're thinking to others as well, so.
I'd like to throw in my opinion on that too. A lot of times when people write down what they did, they don't think about the fact that a resume is a document that's trying to tell an employer what you can do. And so unless you want them to interpret your past experiences for what their job entails, and that takes a little bit of work, you need to tell them what skills you learned, or how you applied it. Like you designed something, or you led a team, or you managed a project. So they can say, this person can manage, this person can lead, this person can design these types of things. And so, you know, if you just said, I helped on a team that did this, it's like, okay, so you helped. What does helped mean? And so you didn't really tell them what your skill was. So you want to translate it for them so that they can see, you know, what they can expect from you. Does that make sense? That's really important. So flip it around. It's an advertising document that you use to sell yourself for somebody in the future.
I wanted to mention, too, a lot of times students think that to put it on their resume, it has to be something they got paid for or a formal program. But if you, in your spare time, work on automobiles or know how to use machine shop tools or help build a house, those kind of skills are important, too. So think about the things that you're self-motivated to do outside of class.
All right. Any other questions?
I have something I want to add.
Go ahead.
So with my experience with internships is I was kind of a little scared on, like, okay, because mechanical engineering is one of the most broadest engineering disciplines out there. So it's, you know, there's a lot of different avenues you can take. But once I figured out, I was like, let's just apply for everything. And because, you know, you might find something you never knew that was even out there. But I think the biggest thing I took away from that is practicing interviewing. Because I sucked in the beginning. But by the time I got, like, you know, 6 or 7 interviews down, I knew how to sell myself. Right. That's ultimately what they're looking for.
Right.
You know, you only have that, you know, 30 minutes, 20 minutes, because their time is just as valuable.
Yeah.
You know, and so you got to deliver it, and you got to know how to do it in a precise manner. You know? So.
Right. Yeah, I think engineers are risk-averse by nature. I mean, we just don't like to fail. But in a case like, a lot of times you learn a lot from maybe not being successful. If you've heard the expression "failing forward," you know, you fail and then you learn from it, and you go and you do better the next time. And pretty soon, now you're being successful because you've learned all these things about it. So if you're afraid to fail, you'll never take that step to learn anything. So it's really important. Good point. Go ahead.
I want to throw one more thing in. When I was interviewing a lot of places, what got me phone calls or second interviews or even like in-person interviews was the fact that one summer I worked in South Korea on a military base as a camp counselor. Nothing engineering related. I'm applying to companies that are building I actually worked at a place that builds aircraft seals for Lockheed Martin and Boeing, and tooling for like the 787, like this type stuff. And when I told them, they looked at that and were like, what is this about? I was like, what did you do? And it was something they were interested in. I talked to them, told them, oh yeah, you know, 10 weeks, I led this program, I traveled, I went here and there. Nothing to do with engineering. They didn't care. They were so stoked and excited. They were asking me questions like, so even if you don't have like actual engineering skills, but you've done something that's cool, you know, worked in this other program that has like other things, you can bring that in. I said, yeah, I was part of a team, I led the team, you know, I wasn't the best at that, but I led the team and I was really pushing everybody to do their jobs and whatever. It's true, you know, it's, I didn't have great interpersonal kid skills, but I was able to get my team motivated. So I talked about that.
You guys were talking about you.
Yeah. So when I talked about that, they got really excited. And they were like, "Oh, that's so cool. Can't believe you got to do that." And they were asking me questions. And the thing is, when you're in an interview, like, you want them to be excited about stuff, even if it's not necessarily, like, the job. If you can get them talking and get them laughing and get them interested, like, you've already sold yourself, and they'll walk out going, "Hey, that kid was actually really cool. Let's call him back in and, like, or take a deeper look at him." Because if you just have, like, a list of, "Oh, I've done this, 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 and this," they don't care. Like, they have hundreds of people who've done that. So, like, bring in other stuff. Bring in cool facts about yourself. Bring in something that they might, like, not see as a skill, but they are interested in. You can promote yourself as a skill and set yourself apart.
Yeah, but I heard you say lead. You led a team, so but you extracted that skill set. That's awesome. Thank you. Yes.
What recommendations would you have for a person who really has no special, like, qualification, standout stuff to do or trying to get an internship?
So. No special skill sets yet. Is that what you're? That's what you're saying.
Meaning, no real like work desk camp in Korea or had stuff like that. Just
well, you know what? I had, and we could go through this exercise. But we had a student in a class in the spring. He said almost exactly the same thing that you just said, and we started talking in the class, and you know it was a smaller class, so we probably don't necessarily need to do it here. We started talking about what things that they had done, and it turned out that they were a leader of a theater. The lighting and like stage management, I guess. I'm not sure exactly what the word. What would that be called, Justin? Stage
technical
craft. Technical. So led that, and we're like, wow, you know, and this person, it was all voluntary stuff that they were just interested in high school and. So this is what you need on your resume. And so that was the types of things that we did. I think it speaks to what Leander was talking about. So you really need to think about what your interests are, and then you know what have you done that you've been passionate about, and see what you can sort of extract from that. And I would say, you know, maybe having a sit down with myself or Leander, we could help you mine that information. It's probably there. Unless you've just been sitting and staring at the wall for, you know, the first 18, 20 years or whatever. So I doubt that's true, right? I mean, you probably got stuff that you've done. So anyway, why don't you come in, and if you have an interest in that, come and make an appointment with Leander or myself, and we can probably help you extract that. It's there.
I guarantee. See, like, I don't even know how to make an appointment.
Well, Leander and
I was just going to say, you get emails from me, don't you? Well, just reply to me and make an appointment with me, and we can talk about it.
Okay.
Plumlee, can I add to that a little bit? Maybe
absolutely.
I think a great starting point would be to join a club, because not only is that going to be something to put on your resume, but you can start networking with people within the club. Because a lot of what today in the workforce is, it's not who you are, it's who you know.
Absolutely.
And that's shown itself time and time again. So I think maybe joining the club would just be a great, you know, starting point to build resumes.
No, I agree. I worked for in NASA at Marshall Space Flight Center, Huntsville, Alabama, and there was I think the guy, you know, back in the 60s, they moved that facility there to build the Apollo missions, and they brought in a bunch of rural Alabama country boys, if you will. And they started, you know, they went to school and got trained up. And this gentleman that I knew, he had worked in the 60s on the Apollo mission as an engineer. And it was funny. I mean, I'm from Texas, so we had a fun relationship. But, you know, he talked like this real slow. Smart guy, but he would tell me that, he goes, "I'm not the smartest guy, but I know who is, and I can go talk to him." You know, and that was his method. So he was as smart as the entire group of people that he knew. And he knew everybody. This guy, if you had any question about anything, he knew exactly who to go talk to. So he totally was on that whole exact situation.
No, can I just mention one more thing?
Yeah.
it's natural to feel uncomfortable about bragging about yourself, and that's really what a resume is, and that's normal and natural, and that's why it's really important to sit down with me or Don, because we can help draw out some of those things that you're probably not mentioning in your resume.
Right, no, that's totally true.
Yeah, so it's okay to brag about yourself. We can help.
You have to, yeah, you have to brag about it. If you don't, who will, right? So, having an excitement and a passion for something speaks a lot. I mean, I definitely. I think people want to work with people who are excited and passionate about the work that they're doing. If you walk in the first day and you're like, I don't really care about this stuff, you know, you're not going to be having an enjoyable experience, and people around you aren't going to be having an enjoyable experience. And they're going to try to make sure that doesn't happen. They're not going to bring in somebody that's not excited about you. So, exactly. I agree. Oh, yeah.
Sure. If you had to do it again, what mistakes did you make that you would like to correct? Opportunities you didn't take advantage of, or things that you, advice you would give out here? They were all perfect.
For me, I accepted, DC was the first internship that came up to me and offered me. So I took it as early February, I want to say. And like the next couple months, I actually started getting more offers. So I'm not saying like I didn't like working in engineering at DC, because I do. But you will get more offers than you think you will. And so sometimes you do want to hold back a little bit and just wait it out so you can just get different varieties in. So you're not, I don't want to say stuck in one place, but yeah.
Kind of add to that, you know, I said that I did my last three summer internships with Barrick. That's because they typically hire really early in the year, so it was great. I already had an internship lined up, but I also haven't had that big of an opportunity to branch out away from the mining industry at all. So if you're getting started early, which you should, you know, you might have an opportunity to do internships in different kind of fields, and you get to try out and find out what you want to do as a career. So I would definitely say start early, earlier than I did, and then don't be afraid to try something new. You know, like I said, I've stuck with the mining industry for 3 years, but that's not necessarily what I want to do forever. It's just what I knew. So,
what was your classification when you first got your first internship?
I was a reliability engineering intern.
No, I mean, what in academically? What, were you sophomore?
I've been here for 5 years, so I was kind of a sophomore, kind of a junior. I was a little in okay. limbo there, but okay. kind of in between. So I would say, if you're a freshman, don't be afraid to apply. Because you never know what will happen. If you get that job, you can start building up your experience, but you also get to kind of say, oh, I really like this aspect of this career field, but maybe if I try this one next time, you'll find something that you'll really enjoy. So,
So EQ Boise, they have well over 1,000 engineers, something like that, over there. And then they hired over 100 summer interns. So I didn't really take the opportunity to actually get to know some of those interns as well as I could have. And if you go to a big company like that, it's good to get to know your other peers, because they come from all over the country. And they could have kind of helped me, like maybe even hear their stories and their experiences and kind of leverage that for maybe where I want to go in the future. But then also when it came time to like doing the internship, I could leverage that a little bit more. Maybe even a little more. I got second place, but I could have got first place if I had, you know, did a little bit networking with my own peers. So, when you go to your internship, be looking around for who your peers are too, because they might have some experiences or hints that you can take away. You never know what it is, you know, but I think I would have maybe enjoyed my summer a little bit more if I had some fun. Because they encourage that future. They have volleyball courts and all kinds of things. But,
you know. The godfather of my son, it was a guy I met in my internship at NASA when I started there back in the early 90s. So I still talk with him. And he's from Marquette, Wisconsin. I would never have any interaction with him at all. I was from Texas. He was from Wisconsin. We met in Alabama. So now he's still a good friend. So. Anybody else? Any other questions? Yes, sir?
Yeah, so like all these summer internships sound awesome. I want to look into that.
But also I'm thinking, like, right now I'm looking for just a part-time job on campus to help make the college. Are there any opportunities, like, industry-wise, where they have maybe those kind of after-school part-time jobs you can also get a little bit of experience?
These are not all summer interns. One, you can do a summer, you can't do a summer internship every semester. You can do an internship every semester. You can do a fall or a spring or a summer. It doesn't really matter. So broad, make sure you keep that in mind. There are people that do internships. In fact, Nathan left. Are you doing one? No, you're not doing one. You did yours this summer too.
Yeah.
I know Nathan, the guy that was here a second ago, he's actually doing one this semester. HVAC group, Siler or something like that. Cilia. Anyway, so he's doing that now. The other thing I would say is some of these students did an internship and then they continued working. It's still an internship, but they're no longer going to be academic credit. But
yeah.
So that's still a possibility. And on top of that, I was going to mention this. I have been approached by our new facilities operations director here on campus, and he is very interested in bringing in. They have an engineering group, campus engineering group, and they're very interested in bringing in interns into that program. And this is a new thing that's not been something that we've looked at before, but I'm in talks with them. So that's another option that, you know, so campus employment, but as an intern and engineer.
Yeah.
So,
great, thank you.
Yeah.
I also
want to
mention, don't wait for a job announcement to come up. Be proactive and look into the mechanical engineering companies in town and send them a resume and have them a letter expressing your interest to work with them.
Yeah.
A lot of them like you to approach them. So don't wait for an announcement. Be proactive all year round. I was going to mention, I did send an announcement about PCS Adventures. Putting it that. That's an after-school program. They do robotics for kids. So someone who's working with kids, someone who's not going, I just sent that out yesterday.
Okay. That's just down the road, too, right?
Yeah.
Here? Right?
Yeah.
Yeah. Right over there, Buck Park.
Grant Hathaway already works there.
Really? And I think Kevin Rial also works there.
That's not
yeah.
Cool.
That's a good one. That's right up there. Any questions at this point? Any comments, questions, thoughts, concerns? Well, I thought somebody would ask about how did you find a house or something more practical. Anybody have any of those questions? Okay.
How did you find a house?
Nice. For those of you who didn't live in Boise, I guess.
With my internship, I was fortunate enough that all I had to pay for was gas and food, so they had housing. They paid for housing and a car rental, and so yeah, stayed in the hotel all summer.
It's really interesting. Boise
had a pool, right?
No pool.
Oh, that's
yeah.
Not
true.
That's the law.
But they had maid service.
They had
maid service.
Else?
I had all the friends that lived in the city, so I was able to serve them.
Oh, that worked that well.
That's the town I grew up in, so I stayed with my parents. But the company that I worked for most of the interns that didn't come from as close or from there, they provided housing as well. They had apartments set up, and you had, it's kind of like living in the dorms. You had like 3 or 4 roommates.
I didn't go out of town, but I know from the interns I did come out of town. The coordinator would try to match up some of the interns with each other, but that didn't really happen. Mostly what they did is they just started calling around looking for summer living. So they got apartments, like some of the apartments you'll see around here. They would go to campus and ask specifically, can I stay here for the summer? And they were able to get some of those.
And furnished, probably furnished.
Yeah, probably, yeah.
That's what I did when I went online years and years ago. I found the internship group that coordinator of the organization always had a list of furnished apartments that you could rent on a month-to-month basis for where I was. So that's how I did it.
What was the work-life ratio for some of your internships? Did they work you like dogs, or did you get some time off, or how does that work?
Yeah, I was full-time. I was 40 hours a week sometimes. It's more like 50. Like, you get paid for 40, but you're always working. But as long as you're, I was doing what I like, so I never really complained. But other than that, it's 8 to 5 each day, and then you get done and do whatever you want. So it's
no homework?
Sometimes I had to learn some heat transfer. So.
That's too bad.
Yeah.
But yeah, I don't know. You do work a lot though. There's a learning curve, so kind of playing catch up. So.
My boss let me make my own schedule, and I didn't have to work when I was going to work. Just kind of. Yeah.
Were you hourly? Was it hourly all?
Yeah, hourly all summer. Just.
So
yeah.
40, probably roughly 40, or is it more?
I chose a setup so I do 32 so I can have a Friday off so I can just do whatever I want. But company is just super flexible with that kind of stuff, and they work completely around my school schedule. And yeah, they're just really flexible.
And you're working there now, right?
Yeah, I'm still working there.
Mine was 30 hours with research, especially. You kind of just gotta be there, you know, when your samples need you. So you're there when they need you.
He's really cool. So I was working 40 hours in the summer, and I'm working 20 hours now. But they're like, if you need to go do something, you can do something. They also let me set my schedule, so I come at 6 and leave at 2 if I wanted to, and I did sometimes. But then also they offer 4 hours of paid volunteer work, so I can leave campus and do volunteer and still get paid, and I'll be at my desk. So one of the things they actually let me do is they actually let me lead an actual Boise State outreach event, and I got paid to do a game that was here on campus. So really cool, really chill, and then just kind of like talk to them and say, I need to do this, and they're okay with it, just as long as you kept them in the loop.
I did 40 hours a week, but they were always encouraging me to do overtime.
You got paid overtime for overtime?
Yeah, I did.
Time and a half, or was it time?
Yeah, time and a half, 15 really? Hours a week, so
sweet.
I was actually doing about 55.
Really?
Yes,
nice.
All summer, so
it's good. So you did it all.
So the mines, most of the regular people that work out there are on 12-hour shifts. So our group, we were 4-10s, so Monday through Thursday I would work 10-hour shifts. So I'd get my 40 hours, and then there were a few Fridays here and there I went in and worked a couple hours overtime here and there, but most of the time it was just Monday through Thursday.
And you got time and a half for overtime? So not really working like dogs unless you want to, but they're getting paid to work like dogs.
Sounds to me like a salaried internship is the way to go, right?
Well, it kind of depends. I mean, it's just different companies probably did different ways. As you heard, there's a lot of variety.
Yeah.
I have a question. How much do you get paid, or what is the average
money
you get paid?
My internship, I got paid $25 an hour. It was decent pay, but they also had to compensate for cost of living. So
yeah, you were just like helpful.
Yeah. So
and also that extra all that free time for work.
Yeah. So it was really to be worth that extra time. So.
The internship was about 15 an hour, and then after the offer and everything else, it just goes up from there. So.
Yeah, with research kind of depends what kind of funding you get. Funding is fine, but I was 13.
I'm at $19 an hour right now, and every year that I'm there, they're made at $2. So,
I was making 16.
23.
Starting out your first summer?
They did it by what level you were as in school. So as a junior, as a senior, it's 23, and then it works back $1 for every grade down.
Pays the work in the gold.
Yeah, the gold industry is kind of nice, but, you know, it's not, that's unique to that field because, you know, the, like, for example, the haul trucks that haul the ore, they hold 300 tons of ore, and I don't know what, an ounce of gold right now is like $1,400, so it's a lot of money driving around.
Yeah.
They might take care of you so you'll walk off that ore.
Yeah.
All right, well, we're getting kind of to the end. Does anybody have any other last minute burning questions that they have for the panel or myself? No? Okay, well, like I said, we have resources. We have resources. I encourage you to get involved, to use the resources, get yourself you know, in contact, start building that network, get your resume together, get in touch with Leandro or myself. My email address is here. Hopefully you can read that. If not, I'm in the front office up there on the second floor by the elevator. So come out. All right, go out and get an internship.